Couple of Swells was written by Irving Berlin in 1947 for Judy Garland's performance with Fred Astaire in the film Easter Parade. Don Dunstan and actor Keith Michelle met at Adelaide University in the late 1940s, when both were involved in student drama classes. Although Keith lived in London from 1949, he and Don remained lifelong friends and always caught up when Keith visited Australia. This song and dance act was the rehearsal for a one-off performance at the Adelaide Festival Theatre, produced for SAS Channel 10's 1976 Christmas charity appeal for the Children's Medical Research Foundation.
You know, when the ABC asked me to do this show, I'm not really quite certain what they thought they were getting. It may well be that since it seems to be received belief in Australia that I'm purely a political animal, that they were looking for politics on the home front, since they told me to talk about what I would talk about at home. And I'm rather reminded of a young man who came to join the Labour Party, and he was full of fire and enthusiasm. And I said to him, Would you like to come home to dinner? And is there some young woman you'd like to bring to dinner with you? And he said, well, yes, there is. And then he looked rueful and said, the trouble is that she really doesn't know terribly much about politics, and she doesn't talk about it either. And I looked at him very sourly and said, well, it is possible for me to talk about other topics. And when he'd picked himself up off the floor, he invited her, and we had a very pleasant evening. I do intend to talk about other things tonight. And I think that the most absorbing thing to me in all of life, really, is the business of communicating with other people. Man is a group animal. Every one of us has a hunger for closeness with other people. And the business of communicating not only in language, but in sense and feeling, in cadence, nuance, in music and art, seems to me to be the essential part of human existence. The highest points, really, of human delight come from communication, involvement with other people. And tonight I want to talk to you particularly about one form of communication through language. And this, to me, has become of central importance, I think, because as a small boy, I was born and brought up in Fiji. And having a Fijian nurse girl, I could speak Fijian as soon as I could speak English. And the Fijians are an intensely musical people. My earliest memory is lying in bed and hearing groups of Fijians drift by to the choral. And they'd always sing. It was quite spontaneous when they were going anywhere, and they'd sing in close harmony because they had an acute musical ear, much more acute than any Westerner has. And I remember going on a launch with my parents, and as we were going along to go for a picnic, a woman on the bank, a Fijian woman, called out to a Fijian woman who was in the boat, and she said, "Kosa lakive." That means, where are you going? But you see how she sang it. And the answer was, Va Tombarua, which is to Tombarua, the name of the island. But it lilted, it sang. And this singing of language, of getting not only the sense, but conveying a further feeling and sense through cadence and diction, and is, I think, a matter of very great delight. The other thing I think that is enormously important in considering language is that if you are brought up in more than one language system, and I not only learnt Fijian as a child, but then at school, like many people, spent a good deal of time learning Latin and Greek and French, you realize that there is thought and sense and feeling far beyond the boundary of the particular language system in which you normally think. Most people, thinking only in English, are very limited in how they can express something. There's much more beyond the boundary that any particular language, flexible as English is, will impose on you. Can I give you another example? I remember going to a house built very high up on a mountain in Fiji. And on the way to it, you didn't see anything of the view because the road was very overgrown. And then we came out in the house onto a balcony, and immediately there was the most breathtaking view, the most beautiful view I've ever seen. It was wide and beautiful and spectacular. And everybody drew breath immediately. And a Fijian who was with us said, "Ah, Sarui Sivia." Now, that means a whole series of things which simply can't be translated into English at all. It means, I'm sorry, I'll try to tell you. I'll try to tell you something of what it means. It means it is painful, beautiful, too much, more than one can express. And it means all of that in those few words. And so in other languages, you have not only different modes of expressing thought, sometimes that you can't do through the barriers of another particular language system, But also, you have a sound and a cadence which can't be repeated in any sort of translation. And so, for me, one of the delights of leisure time has been to read some of the Greek poets, and particularly the greatest woman poet in history, Sappho. And I'd like, if I may now, to try to reproduce for you the sound of what she was conveying in this beautiful fragment. Amphithudor, Suchron nonamas kalade deuston, Malinon, Aithusomenon diphudon, Koma katari. Which means, by the cool water the breeze murmurs, rustling through apple branches, while from quivering leaves streams down oblivion. Of course, there are many people who think that English is a very cold language and it doesn't have that kind of music. And I remember a very beautiful lady writing to me some time ago and saying that she wasn't able to write to me in English, English not being her mother tongue. She could write English, but she said that she couldn't write in English because it was such a cold language. She would have to write to me in French, which she did very, very charmingly. And I would have liked, and alas, I was not able to be able to show her something of the music of English. And I should have, if I'd had the opportunity, quoted to her immediately that beautiful poem of William Butler Yeats. Had I the heavens embroidered cloths, enwrought with golden and silver light, the dim and the blue and the dark cloths of night and light and the half-light, I should spread my cloths under your feet. But I, being poor, have only my dreams. I have spread my dreams under your feet. Tread softly, because you tread on my dreams. But I don't suppose it's at all surprising, given the kind of music that can actually occur in English, that Shakespeare should have swept the world as the world's greatest dramatist and one of its greatest poets. And it must be terribly difficult, it seems to me, to cope with Shakespeare in translation, because there is so much music in what he writes. So much of what he needs to convey is in the music of the language itself, which is virtually untranslatable. Shall I compare thee to a summer's day? Thou art more lovely and more temperate. Rough winds do shake the darling buds of May, and summer's lease hath all too short a date. Sometime, too hot, the eye of heaven shines, and often is his gold complexion dimmed. And every fair from fair sometime declines by chance or nature's changing course untrimmed. But thy eternal summer shall not fade, nor lose possession of that fair thou owest. Nor shall death brag thou wanderedst in his shade, when in eternal lines to time thou growest. So long as men can read or eyes can see, so long lives this, and this gives life to thee. But it's not only in English verse that the beauty of English language occurs. I think that the significant thing about the beauty of English language is in its contrast of vowel and consonantal sounds. It's very different from the liquid sound of Italian, with its constant use of labials. Very different from the schlumpf of the German. Very different from the nasal running and R sounds of the French. The clipped consonant of the English, together with its varying vowel sounds, I think is its particular beauty. And I want to read to you, if I may, I think one of the most sublime pieces of English prose. It was a devotion of John Donne. Donne was lying ill in bed and heard a bell tolling some other out of this world. So will you please imagine, if you would, in the Shakespearean form, a bell tolling in the background. Perchance he for whom this bell tolls may be so ill as that he knows not it tolls for him. And perchance I may think myself so much better than I am, as that they who are about me and see my state may have caused it to toll for me, and I know not that. The church is Catholic, universal, so are all her actions. All that she does belongs to all. When she baptizes a child, that action concerns me. For that child is thereby connected to that head, which is my head too, and engrafted into that body, whereof I am a member. And when she buries a man, that action concerns me. The bell doth toll for him that thinks it doth. And though it intermit again, yet from that minute that that occasion wrought upon him, he is united to God. Who casts not up his eye to the sun when it rises? But who takes off his eye from a comet when that breaks out? Who bends not his ear to any bell which on any occasion rings? But who can remove it from that bell which is passing a piece of himself out of this world? No man is an island entire of itself. Every man is a piece of the continent, a part of the main. If a clod be washed away by the sea, Europe is the less, as well as if a promontory were, as well as if a manor of thy friends or of thine own were. Any man's death diminishes me, because I am involved in mankind, and therefore never send to know for whom the bell tolls. It tolls for thee. You know, I don't think it's surprising. I have to stand up for this one because I get so excited about it, actually. I don't think it's surprising that the people amongst the English races who enjoy the music of language the most, the Celts. There is a certain constant lilt in Celtish sound. And so it's natural enough that these days we should find that Richard Burton, a Celt, is the best exponent of the greatest of modern Celtic poets. Enormously musical. I can't do a Burton. I'm not wouldn't. Sorry. But I should like to read you this poem, if I may. Fern Hill. Now, as I was young and easy under the apple boughs, about the lilting house and happy as the grass was green, the night above the dingle starry, time let me hail and climb, golden in the heydays of his eyes. And honored among wagons, I was prince of the apple towns. And once below a tartan, I lordly had the trees and leaves trail with daisies and barley down the rivers of the windfall light. And as I was green and carefree, famous among the barns, about the happy yard and singing as the farm was home, in the sun that is young once only, time let me play and be golden in the mercy of his means. And green and golden, I was huntsman and herdsman. The calves sang to my horn. The foxes on the hills barked clear and cold. And the Sabbath rang slowly in the pebbles of the holy streams. All the sun long, It was running, it was lovely, the hay fields high as the house, the tunes from the chimneys, it was air and plain, lovely and watery and fire green as grass. And nightly, under the simple stars, as I rode to sleep, the owls were bearing the farm away. All the moon long, I heard, blessed among stables, the nightjars flying with the ricks and the horses flashing into the dark. And then, to awake, and the farm, like a wanderer white with the dew, come back, the cock on his shoulder. It was all shining, it was Adam and maiden, the sky gathered again and the sun grew round that very day. So it must have been after the birth of the simple light and the first spinning place, the spellbound horses walking warm out of the whinnying green stable onto the fields of praise. And on it, among foxes and pheasants, by the gay house under the new-made clouds, and happy as the heart was long, in the sun born over and over, I ran my heedless ways. My wishes raced through the house-high hay, and nothing I cared at my sky-blue trades. That time allows, in all his tuneful turning, so few and such morning songs, before the children green and golden follow him out of grace. Nothing I cared in the lamb-white days that time would take me up to the swallow-thronged loft by the shadow of my hand in the moon that is always rising, nor that riding to sleep I should hear him fly with the high fields and wake to the farm forever fled from the childless land. Oh, as I was young and easy in the mercy of his means, time held me green and dying, though I sang in my chains like the sea. I don't think that in Australia yet we have produced music of that kind. We've had good poets, some very remarkable ones, but not music in that way. We have, I think, very much our own thing. And we have, I believe, one of the greatest of women poets today, here, Judith Wright. And I should like to read you her sonnet for Christmas. I saw our golden years on a black gale, our time of love spilt in the furious dust. Oh, we are winter caught and we must fail, said the dark dream, and time is overcast. And woke into the night, but you were there, and small as seed in the wild dark we lay. Small as a seed under the gulfs of air is set the stubborn heart that waits for day. I saw our love, the root that holds the vine in the enduring earth, that can reply, nothing shall die unless for me it die. Murder and hate and love alike are mine. And therefore, fear no winter and no storm, while in the knot of earth, that root lies warm. I think that one of the things which, to me, gives some hindrance, really, to all the things that I've been talking about, the business of relating to other people, enjoying other people, establishing what is in fact a sensible, a sensitive, and a sensuous relationship. There's a group of people in the community who take, I think, diametrically the opposed view. And they believe that they should have a behavior which is very restrictive indeed. They like themselves to wear hair shirts. and they like to impose the hair shirts upon other people. You know, sometimes we see them rather right now going round to Australian cities waving banners of light. And now, of course, if people's own mode of existence is such that they believe that there should be a number of restrictions upon it, then that's for them, it seems to me. But I don't see that they have any right to institutionalize their own inhibitions and impose them upon other people. And so we have a debate today about censorship. I've been in this debate about censorship for quite some time because I was Attorney General at the time of the first Dirty Books Conference. And I went and listened to all these people who were playing pawn politics. You know, they used to go off to Denmark or somewhere like that and come back with some fairly explicit material, which was introduced by special permission of the customs so that everybody could see what not to bring into Australia. And they'd go... And then go round to communion breakfasts and produce this, horrify everybody, and while they were all shivering, they say, we mustn't let Australia have any of this. And so they wanted to impose a rigid censorship system under which people were told what they could read and what they couldn't, because there were to be a group of censors who could withstand depravity and corruption, while the rest of us, of course, weren't competent to do so. Well, I took some pleasure, as a matter of fact, in hauling out this book to explain my stand to these gentlemen who were professed liberals. Areopagitica, a Milton pamphlet, which is not only expressing what I mean here very well, but does it very beautifully. And he's referring in this passage in Areopagitica to Dionysius Alexandrinus, who had a vision. And the worthy man, loath to give offence, fell into a new debate with himself. What was to be thought? When suddenly a vision sent from God, it's in his own epistle that he avers it, confirmed him in these words, read any books, whatever, come to thy hands. For thou art sufficient both to judge aright and to examine each matter. And to this revelation he assented the sooner, as he confesses because it was answerable to that of the apostle in the Thessalonians, prove all things, hold fast that which is good. And he might have added another remarkable saying of the same author, to the pure all things are pure. Not only meats and drinks, but all kind of knowledge, whether of good or evil. The knowledge cannot defile, nor consequently the books, if the will and the conscience be not defiled. For books are as meats and barns are, some of good and some of evil substance. And yet God, in that unapocryphal vision, said, without exception, rise, Peter, kill and eat, leaving the choice to each man's discretion. Wholesome meats to a vitiated stomach differ little or nothing from unwholesome. And best books to a naughty mind are not unapplicable to the occasions of evil. Bad meats will scarce breed good nourishment in the healthiest concoction. But herein the difference is of bad books, that they to a discreet and judicious reader serve in many respects to discover, to confute, to forewarn, and to illustrate. Had anyone written and divulged the erroneous things and scandalous to honest life, misusing and forfeiting the esteem had of his reason among men, if after conviction this only censure were adjudged him, that he should never henceforth write, but what were first examined by an appointed officer, whose hand should be annexed to pass his credit for him, that now he might be safely read, it could not be apprehended less than a disgraceful punishment. Whence to include the whole nation, and those that never yet thus offended under such a diffident and suspectful prohibition, may plainly be understood what a disparagement it is. So much the more, whereas debtors and delinquents may walk abroad without a keeper,
But unoffensive books must not stir forth without a visible jailer in their title. Nor is it to the common people less than a reproach. For if we be so jealous over them as that we dare not trust them with an English pamphlet, what do we but censure them for a giddy, vicious and ungrounded people in such a sick and weak state of faith and discretion as to be able to take down nothing but through the pipe of a licenser? Well, they would have us, you know. They would have us subject to a license to be able to read what we like. And this whole attitude stems from what I think is a meanness and strangeness of spirit which I have very little accord with. This restrictiveness upon human behavior is something that makes my hackles rise. I can remember when I was first in Parliament, I had a youth group going in my district. And we were refused the right to use a local church hall, not because somebody else wanted to use it, but because we intended to teach the kids ballroom dancing. It wasn't a rock or anything like that. Ballroom dancing. They must have been reading the Reverend Herbert Lockyer, who in this century, after the introduction of the Charleston, believe it or not, wrote Words of Help for Christian Girls. The bodily contact demanded by the present modes of dancing are most unseemly. Is it a comely thing to see a man's wife pressed to the bosom and whirled around in the arms of another man? Is it a pleasant thing to see a Christian girl in the embrace of a young man who has no thought of God? But the strange function of this particular attitude is that it seems that some of these people are so repressed themselves that they have to indulge in fantasies to get a little bit of release somewhere. They don't have the fantasies about themselves. That, of course, is too disturbing. No. They have these fantasies, all right. But then they fasten them on other people. And the people upon whom they most often fasten them, of course, are public figures. Oh, this has happened right down history. You know, Holinshed, Suetonius. It happened in all those days in the past, and it happens right now. Public figures are the subject of all sorts of the most bizarre rumours. And the people concerned feed upon the same sort of prurience as you get in some of our worst newspapers in this country. You know, the kind of newspaper that proclaims veracity in its title and exhibits fantasy in its content. Well, you know the sort of thing. It is reported that scenes of unbridled license and passion are taking place in a doctor's surgery in a certain Melbourne suburb. It is alleged that the doctor is violating his girl patients. It is alleged that shortly there will be an exposure of this whole matter. Pure fantasy, of course. But people buy the paper and say, oh, isn't it terrible? And of course, I have suffered from the fixation of fantasies on me, my fair share, or perhaps some might say a little bit more than. And every so often, one of my friends comes home, bursts in the door and says, hey, mate, listen, the latest? I was on the bus today and an old biddy announced to the bus in, you know, very loud tones that she had it on the best authority that now you... And he'd go on. We have a heck of a laugh. And after a while, I'm obliged to point out to these friends of mine that, you know, if a tenth of the things that were said about me were true, I should not be able to manage. I'm an ordinary human being, and I should be in the case of Mr. Shandy's bull. About about whom I should now like to read to you. Tristram Shandy is one of the most beautiful pieces of English literature, one of the gayest and brightest pieces, and this, I think, is one of the best bits. That provision should be made for continuing the race of so great, so exalted, and godlike a being as man, I'm far from denying. But philosophy speaks freely of everything, and therefore I still think, and do maintain it to be a pity, that it should be done by means of a passion which bends down the faculties and turns all the wisdom and contemplations and operations of the soul backwards. A passion, my dear, continued my father, addressing my mother, which couples and equals wife and wise men with fools, and makes us come out of our caverns and hiding places more like satyrs and four-footed beasts than men. Oh, I know it will be said, continued my father, availing himself of the prolepsis, that in itself, and simply taken, hunger or thirst or sleep, it is an affair neither good nor bad or shameful or otherwise. Why then did the delicacy of Diogenes and Plato so recalcitrate against it? And wherefore, when we go about to make and plant a man, do we put out the candle? And for what reason is it that all the parts thereof, the ingredients, the preparation, the instruments, and whatever serves thereto, are so held as to be conveyed to a cleanly mind by no language, translation, or periphrasis whatever? The act of killing and destroying a man, continued my father, raising his voice, and turning to my uncle Toby, you see, is glorious. And the weapons by which we do it are honorable. We march with them on our shoulders. We strut with them by our sides. We gild them. We carve them. We enrich them. Nay, if it be but a scoundrel cannon, we cast an ornament upon the breech of it. And my uncle Toby laid down his pipe to intercede for a better epithet, and Yorick was rising up to batter the whole hypothesis to pieces when Obadiah broke into the room with a complaint which cried out for immediate attention. And the case was this. My father, whether by ancient custom of the manor or as improprietor of the great tithes, was obliged to keep a bull for the service of the parish. And Obadiah had led his cow on a pop visit to him one day or other the preceding summer. I say or other, because, as chance would have it, it was the day on which he was married to my father's housemaid. So one was a reckoning to the other. Therefore, when Obadiah's wife was brought to bed, Obadiah thanked God. Now, said Obadiah, I shall have a calf. So Obadiah went daily to visit the calf. She calf on Monday, on Tuesday, on Wednesday, at her father's. The cow did not calf. No, she'll not calf till next week. The cow put it off terribly, till at the end of the sixth week, Obadiah's suspicions, like a good man's, fell upon the bull. Now, the parish being very large, my father's bull, to speak the truth of him, was no way equal to the department. He had, however, got himself somehow or other thrust into employment, and as he went through the business with a grave face, my father had a high opinion of him. Most of the townsmen, and please your worship, quoth Obadiah, believe that 'tis all the bull's fault. But may not a cow be barren, replied my father, turning to Dr. Slop. It never happens, said Dr. Slop. But the man's wife may have come before her time, naturally enough. Prithee, has the child hair on his head? Asked Dr. Slop.
It is as hairy as I am, said Obadiah.
Obadiah had not shaved for 3 weeks. Cried my father, beginning the sentence with an exclamatory whistle. He could probably whistle better than I could. And so, Brother Toby, this poor bull of mine, who is as good a bull as ever peed, and might have done for Europa herself in better times, had he but 2 legs less, might have been driven into Doctor's Commons and lost his character, which to a town bull, Brother Toby, is the very same thing as his life. But lad, said my mother, what is all this story about?
A cock and a bull, said Yorick, and one of the best of its kind I ever heard.
It's inevitable that if you're a politician in this country, you have some nostalgia for rhetoric. I say nostalgia because, in fact, these days rhetoric is, for reasons which I'll explain, somewhat out of fashion. However, it does so happen that many of our parliamentarians live in the mistaken 19th century view that the duty of a parliamentarian is to make speeches in Parliament. And they go through a whole series of elocutionary exercises which get no work done and serve no purpose other than something of an ego trip. And it's true that these days you don't get people placing a very great deal of importance upon rhetoric. I think it's significant that Sir Robert Menzies was an eloquent and polished speaker, but he could evoke from an audience nothing like the response that the sincere Ben Chifley could get with his inadequate delivery and his gravelly voice. I, naturally enough, being interested as I am in language, went to some trouble as a student to study the greatest of the rhetoricians. And I tried it out. I had a few unpleasant lessons as a result. I remember one dreadful occasion. I was appearing in the Supreme Court in a case back in the days when I actively practiced law. And it was a difficult case. I worked terribly hard at it. And I prepared a speech to the jury, which I thought, modestly, was a classic. Very good. I brought in every shade of the case, every conceivable fact that could bear upon the verdict, everything favorable to my client. I did it with passion and with eloquence, and I believed sincerity, because I really believed in my client's innocence and do to this day. And after I delivered the address to the jury, I'd obviously impressed the lawyers. The jury went off. The prosecutor and the judge had both, in effect, summed up for an acquittal, and the judge sent me a nice little note down saying, well done. And the jury came back and convicted my man. And I spent sleepless nights thinking, how have I failed him? What did I do wrong? And I went and watched carefully what was happening before juries, which I should have done earlier. Juries paid very much more attention to those who bumbled a bit, who made mistakes in front of the jury, who seemed to be ordinary human beings with whom they could identify. And those who were eloquent, smooth, polished, got no result at all. It was a lesson. So when I became a member of Parliament, I naturally watched very carefully what was happening amongst my peers in the House. I saw some interesting things happen over a while. At times, you know, you've got the grossest of rodomontade. People got terribly enthusiastic. This sort of thing, I remember very vividly. We, who are the guardians of the past, carrying the crimson thread of kinship down the corridors of time, remembering always those dear boys of ours who have so defended this country that their bones lie bleaching on foreign soil. Well, God only knows what it meant, but it sounded terrific. Well, then there were those earnest and bucolic gentlemen who talked on rural matters. And I can remember, I used to hear detailed exegesis of the sex life of the codlin moth and the like. I can remember one incredibly lactose old guy who always talked on the dairy industry, and I think his finest moment was this. The whole trouble with the dairy industry in this country, Mr. Speaker, is that a number of people engaged in the dairy industry went to the war and got killed. Mr. Speaker.
And then they took no further part in the industry. But I hope you'll forgive me if I indulge a little nostalgia again in the rhetoric. Sometimes these days it is a fashion from those who attempt it in this country to go in for the device of the rhetorical question, and some people in South Australia do this, I think, ad nauseam. But there was a speech which was particularly dramatic one, in which the rhetorical question was used to an enormous extent, but I think to very great effect. Cicero was one of the greatest of the Latin orators. He did, I think, in real life much better in the cut and thrust of the court than he did sometimes in the Senate. He used to spend enormous trouble on his speeches in the Senate, and quite often it happened that he wasn't able to deliver the speeches which he had prepared. However, he always used to publish them to say what he would have liked to have said on those occasions. But this particular speech he did deliver, and it was on a particularly dramatic occasion. Cicero was one of the two consuls, and Catiline had stood against him in the election and been defeated, and subsequently plotted the overthrow of the consulate, the murder of most of the senators, and the establishment of a dictatorship in Rome. Cicero knew what was happening, had kept a very close watch on Catiline, had fortified the city, fortified the Senate chamber, and had himself guarded. And so Catiline's plot failed. But then Catiline had the temerity to turn up in the Senate when they knew what he was at. He came into the Senate. The rest of the senators drew away from him, and Cicero fell on him with this enormous piece of invective. I propose to deliver it to you in the Latin, because that's how it ought to sound. I hope you won't mind if I don't translate it literally, but the effect of what Cicero was saying was, just how long, Catiline, is this particular mood and action of yours going to go on and abuse us? Don't you realize that the game's up? Doesn't anything here move you? The fright of the populace, the gathering together of good men, the guards, this place of holding the Senate, carefully guarded, the looks upon these people's faces. We know what you were doing last night and the night before, and whom you saw and what counsel you took. You were marking us all down for murder. The Senate knows this, the consul sees it, and yet this man lives. Quo usque tandem abutere, Catilina patientia nostra? Quem diu etiam furo iste tuus nos saludet? Quem ad finem se seafranata iactabita dacia? Nihil ne te nocturnum praesidium palatii, nihil urbis vigiliae, nihil timor populi, nihil concursus bonorum omnium, nihil hic munitissimis habendi senatus locus, nihil horum hora vultusque maverunt? Patientia tua consilia non sentis? Constrictam, iam, horum omnium scientia tenere coniurationem tuam non vides? Quid proxima, quid superiore nocta aegeris? Ubi fueris, quos convocaveris, quid consili caperis, quem nostrum ignorare arbitraris? Quod tempora mores, sonatis haec interrogat, consul vides, hic tamen vivit.
Well, That was political invective at its most effective, and thank God I've never been subjected to it. But I'd like to read you now a very different speech from a very different sort of orator. Edmund Burke was known as the dinner bell of the House of Commons. He wrote well, but his delivery was frightful, and so everybody used to go off and have a meal rather than listen to that bore. But if you could stay through the boring bits, there were occasionally quite sublime passages in his speeches. This, I think, is one of his most famous addresses, and it's his speech on conciliation with America, where he was urging the withdrawal of the stamp taxes which had caused the American Revolution. Sir, I think you must perceive that I am resolved this day to have nothing at all to do with the question of the right of taxation. Some gentlemen startle, but it is true. I put it totally out of the question. It is less than nothing in my consideration. I do not indeed wonder, nor will you, sir, that gentlemen of profound learning are fond of displaying it on this profound subject. But my consideration is narrow, confined, and wholly limited to the policy of the question. I do not examine whether the giving away a man's money be a power accepted and reserved out of the general trust of government, and how far all mankind in all forms of polity are entitled to an exercise of that right by charter of nature, or whether, on the contrary, a right of taxation is necessarily involved in the general principle of legislation and inseparable from ordinary supreme power. These are deep questions where great names militate against each other, where reason is perplexed and an appeal to authorities only thickens confusion. For high and reverend authorities lift up their heads on both sides, and there's no sure footing in the middle. This point is the great Serbonian bog betwixt Damietta and Mount Cassius Old, where armies whole have sunk. I do not intend to be overwhelmed in that bog, though in such respectable company. The question with me is not whether you have a right to render your people miserable, but whether it is not your interest to make them happy. It is not what a lawyer tells me that I may do, but what humanity, reason, and justice tell me that I ought to do. Thank you.
I'm determined that my death will be useful.
All the world's a stage, and all the men and women merely players. All the world's a stage, and all the men and women and their entrances, and one man in his time plays many parts, and one man in his time plays many parts.
The important thing in Adelaide, you know, is that people are able to do their own thing.
Because when you find it doesn't work, you'll all be a lot poorer, and so will the labour movement.
And baseless rumours about the Hindmarsh Building Society and its liquidity.
Oh, I said I'd come, so I'm here.
You won't have the rest of the trades union movement with you, and you will defeat the whole aim of unionism for conditions in this country.
Now, that is what we have to fight now. They will say that they should be able to decide whether the mining companies come in here, but that they will consult you beforehand. That gives you no protection at all. Never agree to that.
Mr. Dunstan, are you in fact a half-caste Melanesian bastard?
No, not really. I'm not a half-caste. I'm not Melanesian, and not, in the technical sense at any rate, a bastard.
Somebody said to me, well, you were a member of the establishment, and I said, well, I suppose I was, but I'm a refugee from it, and thank God for somewhere honest to flee to.
I turned up in a pair of shorts, which was no different in colour from a heck of a lot of the colours that were being worn around by other people wearing shorts in the place. But because they happened to be that sort of pink denim colour, it turned up in the press as flesh pink hot pants.
This will be the most up-to-date theatre complex or performing arts complex anywhere in this country. Nobody else will have anything as good.
Sir Charles Moses is here with us tonight, and Sir Charles, welcome back to what is really your baby. It's been great to have had you, the real creator of the ABC, back here with us.
If I'd known you in your early days, you'd have been general manager now.
I'm going to cook a cheesecake, and I can hear a few of you groaning. If Dame Edna Everidge were to eat it, she wouldn't feel the same person at all.
We will be back there in 3 years' time to see to it that the things that we delivered, not only to South Australia, but as an example to the whole of the rest of this continent, that South Australia will again be the pacemaker of Australia, and the Labour Party will be in office with John Bannon as Premier.
In the past, we in Australia have had great performers. People like Judith Anderson and Robert Helpman, Keith Michelle.
With the legs like his in summer, he looks cute in a pair of shorts.
The clear advice of my doctor is that I must resign.
I would like to be remembered for making South Australia a better, freer and happier place.
Till the rain stops, lose your blues, laughing at life. No road is lonely if you will only smile through your tears, laughing at life. Live for tomorrow, happier today.
Give me a soul at peace from passionate ways, a fearless mind unmarred by man or fate. So, praising God, I'll graft and prune my trees till death comes softly to my garden gate.
No regret, although our love affair has gone astray. No regrets, dear, although you are far away. Somehow our happy romance
regrette rien.